Damn, son. It is now time for the final drive.
This is it. We gonna go deep, man. Nothing else don't matter, man.
Can I hit that quarterback in the face? Because I do it. I want to do it. I want to hit that quarterback in the face. No flag.
That's a W. That's E1. That's E1. That's a W.
Sick. Put this to music. I don't think he stepped out either. That may be the greatest catch I've ever seen.
Chris Collinsworth isn't incorrect. This indeed was sick to watch. What is going on, everyone? Welcome to the Pond Drive here on Fishbowl Radio Network, FBR US. We're shooting out today from beautiful Choctaw Stadium here in Arlington. It is Alec, DeAndre, and Javonte. Tony joining us via Skype, which means I am behind the computer. And I have my own cam. You can see me. You can see DeAndre Javonte as well, and DeAndre's fancy schmancy big boy camera.
Yep.
What kind of camera is that, DeAndre?
You know what? I honestly don't know. It's a. It's like an M50 something. I don't know. I spent like $800 on it.
Hey, I dig it.
Yeah.
I respect it.
Appreciate it. I'm not big like into technical terms as far as like understanding cameras.
The specs and the frames and the
yeah.
It just looks nice.
Me, I just wanted something that would look nice, can point, shoot, and that's it.
Tony, are you there, bud?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, well, all right, guys. With some breaking news to get into, as you could tell by the introduction for today, Odell Beckham Jr. officially has signed with the Los Angeles Rams a 1-year deal. This essentially came out of nowhere. I don't know why they did that. As of this morning, the Rams aren't even in the mix nor the conversation to land OBJ. This is surprising. It looked like it was going to be the Packers, the Chiefs, the Patriots, or the Saints. Those are the four teams that look to be in the mix all throughout this whole thing. So I will throw it to you guys. What are some of your thoughts on this news coming out, breaking here on the final drive? Odell Beckham Jr. signs a 1-year deal with the Los Angeles Rams.
All I can say, man, is the rich get richer, right? Like, wow. You look at this Rams team, and around the trade deadline, we think, wow, this team, already one of the best teams in the NFC, is establishing itself as one of the best teams in the NFC and has a chance at a Super Bowl run, at making a Super Bowl run. And they acquire a guy on that defense like Von Miller, who can ultimately, you know, improve this defense, which is already one of the best in the league. With Aaron Donald at the defensive line position, and then Jalen Ramsey in that secondary. And you look at this offense now. We point back to, getting another guy in that receiving room after losing DeSean Jackson. I thought it was just going to be Van Jefferson stepping up to be that number three, which, you know, he's kind of a favorite of Matthew Stafford when he's not looking at Cooper Kupp. The Rams, they just surprised me, man. I guess it just came, an hour ago that the Rams were even showing interest in Odell, where it was down to the Rams and the Packers. And to see them come out with Odell Beckham as part of that receiving room with Cooper Kupp and Robert Woods, I mean, just piles on expectations for a Super Bowl this year. Like, they are my clear favorite for the Super Bowl. This was after the Von Miller signing, but now, like, I'm just shocked by it.
Yeah. Javonte, I think before we went on, you were saying this team made the most sense to you, even though we had no clue about the Rams having interest, you know, up until Mike Dodger mentioned about an hour ago. I mean, Wise Odell, a perfect fit for that team.
I just feel it's the best fit for both of them. I think for Odell, he needs to go to a situation where he has a quarterback that's proven, that can give him the ball. And because I think he has to make up, because people think he's probably washed or like he's a bad locker room guy. So I think it's the perfect situation to be on a winning team where he has a coach that's very offensive, like very good on offense with Sean McVay. And so like they can find ways to give him the ball. So I like the move in general. I thought before they were announced, when he first got released, I thought, oh, the Rams would make sense just because of Sean McVay and how great he is and the weapons they have around him. It kind of reminded me of how the Buccaneers did with AB, getting AB last year, and how the impact he had throughout the season in the Super Bowl. So I like the move for both teams. You know, the Rams, they're pretty much saying, we're going all in. You know, I kind of respect it. You know, forget the draft pick, all that kind of stuff. Just look at the stars, look at players that are proven. I think he's going to have a real good impact on this team. So I'm curious to see it play. Hopefully he plays on Monday night.
Yeah, could not agree. It's going to be interesting. Tony, you texted in the group chat right when this happened that none of us are happy about this. I personally not happy. Go into an explanation as to why you are not happy about this move.
It's because, like, we DeAndre kind of hit the mark. Like, it was already a Super Bowl team. It's one of the favorites. It was depth that they actually didn't really need. Like, point out Van Jefferson. I think Van Jefferson's a great number three receiver. Robert Woods is still, like, a quality number two, and Cooper Kupp is just Cooper Kupp. And Stafford really doesn't need those many weapons. I could throw in Tyler Higbee, too, but Henderson, you know, like, do they really need Odell? Like, it just seemed like really, like, was this necessary? But it's whatever. I don't care. I knew my team wasn't going to go after him.
My team was the only one in this entire conversation that had a shot.
I mean, when we look at the teams that were considering the running for Odell, I mean, no offense, Alec, I just did not think the Saints were
up there. Can I counter to your point as to why I think they would have been in serious consideration?
Sure, go ahead. Give me your reason.
Okay, so here's my thing, right? So Rappaport came on the Pat McAfee show earlier today and mentioned that Odell was going to, you know, before this happened, he's going to take his time, take the weekend. He wants to find a team for the next 2 to 3 years that he can, like, really, you know, gel with. And if you look at the Saints this year, right, they're probably not going to go very far in the playoffs. I think they're a playoff team still with Trevor Siemian. And, look, Sean Payne, I think, was going to sell Odell on the idea of, look, come with this team this year, see what it's like, get with this culture and this locker room. But here's the thing about Odell, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's a very sensitive guy, but we all know it is what it is. And to see how it ended in New York when he got traded out of nowhere, and then to see how it ended in Cleveland, Odell, I think, just needed somebody to feed him and believe that he still can be that elite playmaker, which I think he is personally. Sean Payne, I think, wasn't even the guy to do that. You buy him in on next year, Michael Thomas is going to be healthy, he'll be back. You buy in on Jameis being back and or a upgrade at quarterback. And I believe if Jameis never got hurt, I think he would have signed the Saints right away.
Yeah.
I think so. And I think Sean was selling him on the future rather than just this half of the season.
And I get that, but, I mean, to sell him on Jameis, because that's the one thing about Jameis was we never really got a definitive answer on whether he improved as a player. Like, sure, he cut down the turnovers, but, like, did he, you know, reach that potential that we all saw in him as a number one pick?
He did. And the receivers are boo-boo, but he did.
Yeah, I mean, you could say I kind of disagree. I do think he was better. He was a lot better this year. Yeah. But he just didn't get that chance. I think he was starting to become that guy, and then sadly, you know, he had that injury he had versus Tampa Bay, ultimately ruined it. And you kind of don't know going into next year, will he be that guy? Will the injury hold him back? What are the Saints' options at QB if Jameis can't go to start the year? So it's kind of one of those uncertainties that, you know, the Saints have that I don't think Odell would have wanted to go into. As far as the other teams, I like the Packers, I like the Chiefs, I like a lot of those other teams, just because of their quarterbacks, in a way. I mean, although the Packers, you don't know with Aaron Rodgers' situation, but, you know, one thing I like about Odell and what he likes in a quarterback is that quarterback that can extend plays outside of the pocket, you know, make those off-platform throws. Because Odell, he's one of those receivers, he's good at his routes, but what a good thing that he's, you know, great at is, like Antonio Brown, he knows how to get open. He knows how to, you know, run around defenses, run around that zone coverage, and get himself open. And I think having a quarterback like Rodgers or Mahomes that can extend plays is someone that he would want to play with. And I think Stafford can do that as well.
All right. Salty about your just shot me down like that, but that's cool. That's cool.
No, man.
That's cool. You don't respect Trevor Siemian.
I respect.
Remember, he declined a Pro Bowl invitation, sir. I'll have you know.
Oh, okay.
He could have been a Pro Bowler 1 year, but he declined.
Yeah. I think also to go along with what y'all saying, I think, I know that's what the Saints like that, but realistically, the Saints just aren't going anywhere as far as, like, they're probably, they go to the playoffs to one. We got another week, and then we're done. You know what I mean? Like, the Rams are legit contenders. I think also Odell Beckham's a guy who likes – he's a big market guy. He's one of the most known players in the NFL. So I think being in a market like L.A., being in SoFi where you have LeBron James and celebrity, I think that just fits what he wanted also. Like, this is the best of everything. Winning, I'm going to get the ball because Matthew Stafford is probably – honestly, I'm not saying all time, but as far as like quarterbacks he's played with so far in his career, Matthew Stafford's probably the best he's played with.
Yeah,
I mean, Eli Manning was past his prime; he was pretty much done when he got there. But so as far as talent wise, defensively,
and probably, you're a Baker hater.
I don't hate Baker. I actually like Baker. I just don't think I think Baker's a good quarterback. I don't think Baker was the guy for Odell Beckham. That's a dual Baker Mayfield. I think he's okay. But yeah, I like the fit. I think the fit is perfect, and I think you know. The guy in most teams he was thinking about going to, and all those teams have one thing in common, Pro Bowl quarterbacks. And the Saints just don't have that right now. So it didn't make sense either way. And you're talking about buying him on future, but it's like, where the Saints, if, let's say Odell Beckham have a great year with the Saints, were they going to pay him a decent contract to come back for the next 3 years, 4 years? He's going to be a free agent, so would they have paid him is the question also.
I think they would have.
You think they would have paid him how much? Like, what do you think around?
Oh,
more than AB for sure.
I can't see off the top of my head, but we can maneuver the cap. We've done it year in, year out.
Yeah, they have done it before. I mean, yeah. Give me Taysom Hill a $100 million contract.
That's not a real contract.
But
I know.
I think to go along with that, though, also, like, it just made sense, like, as far as like, the money-wise, like, trying to get a contract this offseason, this is going to put him in the best situation to be seen, see what he can do, show he can still produce as a receiver and be a, if not one or two in this league, you know what yeah. I mean? So it's been best.
And like Javonte mentioned with Sean McVay coaching, you know, he's going to find a way to get all three of those guys a fair share of targets on Sundays.
Let's hit on Baker more, not dislike, but Kevin Stefanski's offense is very basic and then fit to Odell. Sean McVay is going to make it work with Odell.
Yeah, I agree. I think I just have a one reaction about all this. Oh, that's a boing. Never mind. I'm about to put a boo sound effect. Never mind. Forget I've tried.
Yeah, well, you can do it. You can do your own boo right here.
No, boo. No, I'm scared. I mean, it makes sense. I mean, it all makes sense for the right reasons. Realistically, New Orleans probably should not have been in this conversation, but the fact that they were, to me, speaks to the pitch Sean Payton threw at him, because it really made him consider.
He probably pitched a lot of home.
And I feel bad. Home. I really do feel bad for you. Like, if anyone wants to know how bad you feel.
I'm stuck with Marquez Callaway and Kenny Stills for another week.
Yeah?
They're trash.
I was going to say, if anybody needs to know how bad Al is in right now, it's just look at his Twitter account. Look at his past couple
at
tweets.
@AASalasNDA, plugging myself in, follow on Twitter. No way. No, what did you say, Javon?
So the Saints own their pick this year?
Yeah, they own
the pick. But we're going to draft a lineman. This is what we do.
Maybe I should trade Michael Thomas.
Let's not do that.
I was just saying, maybe. Is he? We sure he the guy still?
Now you want to go from having a potential two receivers with Odell and Michael to having no receivers.
Yeah, let's not test those waters.
You probably get some nice compensation.
I've been pointing that out. I've been saying, what if Michael Thomas isn't the same as he once was just because of an injury?
I think also Drew Brees will make him look better.
Tony, you're just having Des Bryant PTSD. It's okay there, bro.
I'm
just kidding.
Des was great. Des was a fantastic receiver in his prime. That's a compliment to Michael Thomas.
And then it quickly kind of... Anyways, let's move on here from OBJ talk. Let's get some of the big plays from this past week 9 of the NFL, starting with a little Josh Allen versus Josh Allen.
On the scoop and the return.
Bills trying to pick it up. They can't. Allen throws. Intercepting. It's Josh Allen. Intercepting Josh Allen.
Allen on Allen crime, you love to see it. Guys, look, this Bills game was surprising to say the least, I think, from almost every corner of the NFL world. The Bills lose 6-9. Josh Allen throws 2 interceptions, no touchdowns. A very lackluster game for Buffalo. And, you know, I don't want to be that guy, but I'm just pointing out there to you guys. Look at the Bills' schedule. Look at their wins and losses. It hasn't looked all that pretty. I'm just going to ask you guys a question. Should we be concerned about the Buffalo Bills? Because I think at one point we all thought this was the best team in football. Or one of the best squads in the NFL. But now we're at the midseason point. Anybody concerned about the Bills?
I think the big...
Not really. Like, if I'm going to be honest, like, this just was like a... I want to say this is a fluke game. It's just like, it's Jacksonville. They've proven to be a bad team. And look, they lucked out. They didn't put up a touchdown either, did they?
3 field goals.
So, I mean, exactly. So, I think this was just a fluke game. There was plenty of those this week. But, yeah.
Oh, you mean the Cowboy game, right? That's what you're going to say? Cowboy game was a fluke game?
Yeah.
Let me ask you, Javonte DeAndre, any reason to be panicking if you're a Bills fan right now?
I definitely think there needs to be panic. But I think the only thing is just the Bills. I think if you look at the AFC in general, maybe even the NFL in general, there really isn't a powerhouse team, especially the AFC. Nobody's really a powerhouse.
I'd say Baltimore is.
Baltimore has their... I watched Cincinnati going a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, and I've seen...
Run them down.
You've seen some of Baltimore wins. Like, they've been narrowly escaping some.
Yeah, they come back and get wins. I mean, they're winning games, but like, I don't see... Like, in the past, we've had the Chiefs, Patriots. You know, I mean, we had teams that were just dominant. We knew, okay, this team right here is legit going to be here.
Yeah.
I don't think we have that this year. Even if you want to say in the NFC also, I mean, I thought the Cowboys possibly were that. Then some people I know are going to say the Broncos came in there and just ran shop, so... But as far as the AFC and the Bills, I think there is concern. I think the Patriots are. If I'm the Patriots, I'm feeling pretty good right now, especially with how we're playing. So I think definitely the Bills need to be concerned.
I don't think the Bills should be concerned. I still think they're the best team in the AFC from a talent standpoint. From looking at their roster top to bottom, I think they feel one of the best. You know, in Jacksonville, look, this was a trap game for them. And as a person with experience of losing to Jacksonville this year, they can surprise you. They can surprise you.
They play for their head coach now.
Hey, the MVP's definitely gone, though. There is no MVP, though.
Wait, Josh, I mean...
6 points, bro.
Yeah.
Got 6 points on the board.
Hey. Well, I would say right now my front runner is Lamar Jackson, but...
Or Kyler.
I'd say Kyler.
Yeah, either one of those two.
Stafford had a bad game last week also.
But. Yeah, I mean, but look at the Bills, like... 4 of the next 5 games, they play the Jets this week, but after that, they play the Colts, the Saints.
That's Mike White. Put some respect on his name.
Okay, man. Fine. The Jets, their next 5 games, they play the Jets with Mike White, which is, you know.
Thank you.
They're a top team, apparently, in Alex's point of view.
He's elite.
They play the Colts, who, you know, they're kind of coming into their own right now.
Taylor's a beast.
Yeah, Jonathan Taylor is really helping that team. Carson Wentz actually showing some improvement, not making too many dumb plays recently. The Saints, the Patriots, the Buccaneers, and yeah, that's a pretty tough stretch of games that they have to at least, I would say, get 3 wins, finish 3-1 within that stretch, or 3-2.
I think all the pressure on to the AFC East. I mean, the AFC East ain't as bad as like the Patriots. Oh, never mind.
The Wizards, the Patriots.
The Patriots could low key win divisions too.
They're making some noise.
Dolphins and Jets are out of it, but the Patriots can still be around. They're looking good these past whole weeks. Like defensively, they're playing well. Offensively, Mac Jones making the right
Dolphins
play.
Ain't completely out of it. I mean, if we win the rest of our games, and you know somehow the schedule of Buffalo and New England.
Please stop.
And, you know,
we don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear it today.
But. No, I'm just kidding. But I'm not panicking yet on Buffalo. I think this is just one of those trap games. It just kind of depends. We'll see Sunday how they play against New York. If they bounce back in a big way by blowing the Jets out, which, I mean, yeah, we saw in recent weeks the Patriots destroyed the Jets. So we'll see how they look against them. And if that comes to a close game or the Jets somehow win, then I'll start panicking. And
what's the you say the Bills' most impressive win was what, the Chiefs game?
Yeah, I'd probably say the Chiefs game.
But see how the Chiefs are playing, does that change? That changes things now.
Yeah,
the Chiefs, how bad the Chiefs are. I was saying, they lost to Tennessee, so like, they don't really have no impressive win.
They lost to Pittsburgh as well.
I mean, and then really quick, you know, Pittsburgh, we had them dead in the water, you know, 2 or 3 weeks ago.
They still did. Dead in the water.
I'm just saying, look, that division is...
I talk for the playoffs, I'm talking about just like making a serious contention.
No, right? For a playoff.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I mean, that division is extremely intense.
It is.
All those teams are above 100. I for me, I look at Buffalo. I'm not too totally worried yet. I am a little concerned about Josh Allen, though, and maybe what kind of quarterback is he really? Because, you know, the plays and the throws that he's made this year almost remind me of, you know, rookie Josh Allen when he came out of Wisconsin.
Yeah.
So it kind of makes you wonder, you know, if you're Buffalo, what do you really have in Josh Allen? Is he the MVP contender we saw last year, or is it not that?
Well, also hope he's that you pay a $200+ million.
That's what I'm saying. I'm not worried about the team itself. I'm more worried about Josh Allen's play.
Well, another thing I call into question is, you know, Buffalo's decision not to trade for a guy like Marlon Mack around the deadline, like, you know, a running back that can, you know, really take pressure off of Josh Allen because.
And is capable of being a lead back.
Yeah, because in recent games, we've seen Josh Allen be the leading rusher of that Bills team. And, you know, I don't like Josh Allen taking too many hits. He doesn't really know how to slide yet. I hope he learns because, you know, eventually there's going to be that one hit that might put him out for a while. And, you know, right. I just think he's taking too much right now. It's kind of similar to Cam Newton and how he was playing early on in his career, kind of reckless, you know?
Yeah, but now he's back home. We'll get into that a little later. Let's take a look at this next clip. This is for you, Dion. This is strictly just for you.
Oh, well, thank you.
This is the first of the three Miami interceptions off of Texans quarterback Tyrod Taylor as they get their second win of the year. And, you know, mathematically speaking.
Well, don't edge them on.
Pressure coming. Threw it early. Intercepted in the end zone. It was floating, and Javon Holland, the rookie, floated over to pick it off.
Turnover for the Miami Dolphins. Yes, that's Tyrod Taylor back in as the starting quarterback for the Houston Texans. He got injured.
Yeah, Dion, just good luck. You did play David Stills this week.
Oh, David Mills?
David Mills, not bad.
Yeah. I guess, according to Mekhi, yeah, I got lucky. No, but you know what sucks? I actually started Tyrod Taylor in my fantasy, in one of my fantasy leagues, because Tyrod Taylor, you look at his career versus the Dolphins, guy had like 10 touchdowns to zero interceptions. Like, some of his best games were against the Dolphins. So the one week I needed that Dolphins defense to finally, you know what, hey, give up some points, give up some touchdowns. Now you want to be all stout and shit, so.
They want to walk him down.
Yeah. even when they win, they still let me down somehow.
That's poetic. That's poetry at its finest, man.
Yep.
So that was a fun game for the Dolphins. I'm sure you were excited about it. And notice today, Javonte, no Dolphin rant. It's glorious when the Dolphins win.
I mean, I don't know if I can say that way. I told you. I said, "Yeah, can you really be happy by beating the Texans?" Like, well, I'll say this. I mean, I'll take it as a win. You know, either way, because it's not like we're sabotaging our draft pick because one, we don't own that pick. It belongs to Philly. So us winning doesn't really matter. Now, San Francisco lost, so I'm happy about that. And looking at Miami, I'm not impressed by this win either. There were too many turnovers. We looked sloppy. And it's against a Houston Texans team that's in the bottom of the league, just like us. And, you know, I expected us to.
It was to his fault, right?
Well, yeah, it can't be his fault. He didn't play. Yeah,
the only reason I get a rant. The only reason I get a rant today because they're the game tonight. We'll get the rant next week.
It's because Tua didn't play. That's why they won the way they did.
Well, there's that. I mean, we don't really have anybody right now at the receiver position. Devontae's now out for 3 weeks. So I mean, who could have guessed that? Him being hurt and all. Will Fuller still isn't back from his injury. You know,
who could have guessed that?
Who could have guessed that either? So
it's funny. I told him years ago, I said, "Guys, Devontae Parker's out there. Bro, he could be a one, bro.
He can't. Talent wise, he could be a one.
Juju a one? Looks like a crazy now.
Juju what? Well, yeah, I thought he was a one. Guy's ready to pay him back a dollar.
That's not crazy. I won't say that now.
Really? Yeah. All offseason I heard Juju, bro. Juju coming to Miami, bro.
Because we already had like two receivers I would.
Juju can't be a wide receiver one, and Darnold can't be a QB one, apparently.
Yeah. Oh man, no, I never went into DeAndre. It's been a bad. Never hit up on no USC quarterback ever again. Never again.
Okay.
Well, only one Carson Palmer. That's the one I'll give you. The rest of them, let's go have a list. It's bad.
Okay, I'm fine with that.
Hey, a couple weeks ago, he'll tell you, bro, we got a good quarterback, but you'll be a good bro. We got a quarterback now. He's going to be nice. I'd love to hear it in a couple weeks. Watch.
Yeah, it happens all the time. Hey, but no, as far as Tua, I'm kind of – it's rough seeing him not play in that game versus Houston. But if I'm not going to play him, I would sit him in that game versus Houston. Apparently, he was throwing mid-game and pregame And he was healthy enough to be the backup quarterback heading into that game. So, and he's healthy enough to be the backup heading into tonight. So we'll see. You know, maybe the fact that we rest him versus Houston indicates that he might play in Baltimore tonight. Well, we'll see. Or in Miami against Baltimore tonight. We'll see. But Tua, right now, it's not looking good, man. I mean, one of the things that you got to show in the NFL is availability. You know, that's it.
Yep.
And right now, he hasn't showed it. He has 8 games right now to prove that he's the quarterback of the future in Miami. If not, then, you know, that obviously that comes to the offseason question of Deshaun Watson. So if I'm Tua, I'm not really missing any games at this point. I'm going to try to – I mean, I would pretty much have to play through anything just to show that I'm the QB in Miami. But it's disappointing to not see him play, but hopefully he's able to play either this week or next week, and we can really get an evaluation of Tua and this Miami Dolphins team for the rest of the schedule.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be interesting. I believe, 11 of the 16 teams in the AFC have a record above 500, so...
Everybody's pretty...
Miami's going to make a comeback here. They're going to claw the way back.
Oh, yeah.
Why you give them that?
Hey, no, but hey, hey, you know, no, I'm just looking. I'm looking at the schedule. We got the Jets twice.
The Jets are not walking the park.
Hey, it's Mike White, man.
I think Zach Wilson might be back in that time, so maybe they might play Zach Wilson. We'll see. But, hey... That could be 2 wins right there. We play a Patriots team that we beat week 1 in the season.
The Patriots are way better than they were week 1.
You're right. And by that time, we'll hopefully be better.
Y'all got it worse by week. Week 1 was y'all best week. Y'all got it worse every week.
Yeah, you're right. Hey, maybe this win was needed against Houston.
Oh, it's motivation.
Yeah, and you know what?
Play tonight?
When we look at the last 2 years with Brian Flores as head coach, as the Dolphins, they've had a better record in the second half of the season, so this year.
Yeah, who knows? You know,
yeah, it's not.
DeAndre talk. He said Brian Flores doesn't have a job next year.
You right? You damn right.
That's because Deshaun Watson won't go to Miami anymore. There you go. It's all.
Shit, I don't even know why he wanted to go to Miami in the first place.
I like Brian Flores this year.
No, he probably liked South Beach. That's what he liked.
Oh, you know why? It's probably because in Miami, I think they have like those open. Like open door masseuse place. They're probably all like, you know, they don't have windows. It's like the natural breeze comes through.
They have them on the beach, you know.
Exactly. So I'm sure that's a big attraction for Deshaun Watson.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, wild, man.
Hey, I don't make this stuff up. I just read it. I did make it up, actually. let's jump into Sunday Night Football, Rams Titans. This is the first game without Derrick Henry, and that didn't matter. Tennessee absolutely had their way with the Rams, including this honor, the pick six by the safeties, having a really phenomenal year so far. Kevin Byard.
He caught a few from Tom Brady. Playing both sides of the ball. And that's going to be picked off at the 24 by Byard for the touchdown. Man, as Keith Jackson would say, whoa, Lily. Can you believe that? Back to back, that's 24 yards for a pick six.
Absolutely crazy. I miss you guys this. Tennessee's the Titans, right? Their wins include now the Colts twice, the Rams, the Chiefs, the Bills. How do you feel about Tennessee? Has your opinion on the Titans changed before Sunday night, or are you buying into this Titans team?
You know what? I'm gonna say this, man.
Here you go.
Hey, how is it that Aaron Donald wasn't even the best defensive player on that field that night? Best defensive lineman, because Jeffrey Simmons.
Yep.
Have yourself a day, man. I mean, he was a great player prospect coming out of Mississippi State, and seeing him now in Tennessee, really anchoring that defensive line. And that's one of the things that we had with Tennessee was a flaw with them, is their defense. How is it going to hold up against the best of the best offenses? And so far, they've done a really good job. I mean, you look at that game in Buffalo, Josh Allen, 4th and 1. What do they do? Make a crucial stop. So when it comes to big moments, this Tennessee defense is actually really showing out. And you know, I'm not going to write off this Tennessee team for losing to Derrick Henry just yet. I think they still have enough to at least win 10 games. You know, whether or not they lose the division or they sneak into that wild card spot, there's that hope that Derrick Henry can come back in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that this Titans team is clinging on right now, is that hope that we just have to persevere, win at least, you know, half of our games.
Just finish better than the Colts.
Yeah, just
finish better. Head-to-heads.
Yeah, pretty much. And that's all you have to do. And then hopefully Keen Henry can return, you know, whether it's the last week of the season, playoffs, either way.
Yeah, I mean, one more thing I'll add on to that, DeAndre. Simmons was great, but also a guy who's going to have a breakout year than one's talking about, Harold Landry III.
Yeah.
Out of, what, Boston College?
Yep, Boston College.
Yeah, I mean, look, he only had half a sack, but if you look at his numbers as a whole, I believe he was tied going into week one of Miles Garrett for sacks in the NFL. He's kind of blossomed to a very good pass rusher for this Titans team. And then another guy I want to mention real quick, Danko Aubrey, the guy from the Colts that they brought over. In the middle of the defensive line, he had a sack and a half last time. He's been a dominant force for that Titans team in the middle. And the offense did just enough. I mean, with Tannehill, I mean, only 143 yards, one touchdown. He had the interception. But this was a defensive win for the Titans. And I know that we talked about Ryan Tannehill, the pressure is on him now without Derrick Henry. But Sunday proved to me the Titans can win games in ugly fashions.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much how, I don't know if it's the state of Tennessee or how it is, because, I mean, we look at the Memphis Grizzlies in basketball. They've always been known as that grit and grind team. I mean, that's what the Titans are. They're that grit and grind. They're going to win those gritty matchups, and that's what I love about them. And, I mean, how about seeing Adrian Peterson return to the field? I mean, he didn't do much, but it's just nice to see Adrian Peterson back in the league.
Well, with that front seven, I'd expect
And but, I mean, the one thing that I'll call it a question, though, is was it really that much of a dominating win by the Titans defense? I do give them credit, but also that Rams offensive line has been the weakest part of their team. So I think, you know, that weakness was really exposed on Sunday night.
Oh, they got Odell. It'll fix that.
Oh, yeah. That cuts off, like, three more seconds of Stafford holding onto the ball in the pocket.
Javante, you're kind of quiet.
Yeah, man. I thought it was Tony.
Let me get Tony.
Yes.
Tony just sitting back, just like.
Yeah, he's just sitting back, chilling, man. This Titans game, man. I mean, we were watching it together Sunday night. What were some of your thoughts on this game?
Well, my main thought was worried about you. You look defeated, crushed.
Well, Stafford's my fantasy quarterback.
Like, I would be going through it, man.
Fantasy was rough.
It was you want to tell
them? Let me think. Who did I have inactive? So I had Derrick Henry. James Robinson was inactive right before kickoff. DeAndre Hopkins was inactive right before kickoff. I picked up Zach Moss, and then Moss got hurt in the Jacksonville game. My best running back of the day was Mark Ingram with, like, 12 points.
Wow.
And Stafford, I needed like 20 points from Stafford. And this is the one game where he, you know, couldn't do anything. Love to see it.
In one of my leads, I have Derrick Henry and Calvin Ridley. So.
Ooh, Tony has Calvin Ridley and now Dalvin Cook. So we'll see what happens with that. But back to this Titans game, Tony. Are you buying in Tennessee as a legit threat in the AFC?
Yeah, because I think I mentioned it last week. This team is capable of being a now we have to convert to a passing team, and they tried, and you can't blame them for not like fully succeeding, because that's a defense that's one of the best in the league. Like I mentioned earlier, AJ Brown and Jalen Ramsey was still somewhat successful. Like I thought, AJ Brown did. With what he had, and Tannehill made the smarter decisions, excluding that first, the first series where he's doing interception. But like I said, this team can't be a pass happy team. They just like I think Tannehill's like sound enough to throw to his tight end, to his running backs in the flats, you know, and not always take that deep shot downfield with you know Adrian Brown.
It was a big win for the Titans. And as you mentioned, Javante, there's no real clear-cut one you know powerhouse team in this conference. We'll have to wait and see how it turns out. But right now, my money's on the Titans.
I like everything y'all said. I think I made some good points. Defense did win that game. Defense played amazing. I wasn't used to Matthew Stafford turning the ball over like that. But I will say, I think they're going to win a division, of course, and I think they'll host a playoff game, but I don't see that as a real competitor in the AFC. Not without their best player. Without Derrick Henry, so much of that offense. Without Derrick Henry, I just don't see how we can really look at them and say they're legit, like contenders.
Well, if we're looking at, because you think they'll be a playoff team, right?
I think they'll win a division because division's not that great.
Yeah, if that's the case, then it's spent a guy like Derrick Henry to combat.
What's the injury again?
Jones fracture.
That's a foot injury, bro. That's kind of
yeah. But what was the timeline? Because he was injured last week, and they mentioned
six to eight. But ten isn't
But you're talking about not moving really, because your foot, you're not moving your foot, so you're basically sitting down all day, or like you're not being able to do a lot of movement. So you tell me you're jumping the game and just be able to just
well,
go crazy.
Well, I'll say to that, Derrick Henry's not known as a player where I got to worry about like. As far as being elusive, you know?
No, I'm saying that, like, conditioning wise, like, he used to carry the ball 20 plus times a game.
Yeah, well, that's what
I'm saying.
That's what having a guy like Adrian Peterson.
Adrian Peterson is washed, y'all. Just stop saying Adrian. He's like,
Adrian Peterson, he ran for 600 yards last year in Detroit. You tell me that he can't.
Split time.
Yeah, splitting time. You tell me he can't run, he can't have an effective run game behind Tennessee's O line?
AP is committed. You know why?
He turned down Dancing
with the Stars this year for an opportunity to play for another.
Hey, look, Father Time catches everybody. I'm just saying. Look,
well, hey, it doesn't work when it comes to Adrian Peterson.
Father Time tried that by tearing his ACL. Yeah. In 2012.
and Adrian Peterson came back and was like, "Oh, so I'm pussy now."
All I'm saying, they could win the division. I think they could win the division. But also, I mean, I think they'll lose some of these games. I think they got like Tony. I think and all I said, like they can win some of these games and grit them out and grit and grind them. And I'm cool. I think that's a realistic thing. I think a first round playoff host is realistic. I don't see him going and make no deep playoff run. Especially with Derrick Henry just coming back off. If that's his first game back in the playoffs, you're telling me that's going to be the game that he's going to be able to break out. And say what you want about Adrian Peterson. Okay, cool, but if Adrian Peterson gashes me, that's okay. But I don't think Adrian Peterson will gash me.
Yeah,
and you're. 15.
And that's the thing that I'll say about Titans moving forward is like when Derrick Henry initially got hurt was the difference between Derrick Henry and Adrian Peterson. Like, I respect Adrian Peterson as that player, that guy, you know, had a great career, you know. I respect him. But at the same time, I'm not going to stack the box like I would for Derrick Henry. So I get that.
Let's keep it real.
There's a difference.
Respect Adrian Peterson, 600 yards, you guys said last year. Why would I send him? The Dolphins could use a running back. Why didn't y'all sign him? Nobody signed Adrian Peterson.
Yeah, because they're concerned with age.
Exactly. So you're telling me nutrition and age by playoff time, if I have Derrick Henry coming back just that first week back in, you're telling me, Adrian Peterson can help carry that load?
I'm not saying
he can, because I mean, you got to think this is a guy who's coming in now really 10 weeks in, you know, the wear and tear.
At what age, though? For a tailback.
And also you define
who plays a great aggressive running style. That's not making sense. Hey,
it's worked so far.
You define carrying the load as I'm thinking like 50-50. I'm not. I'm thinking more of 70-30. Like he gets a partial share. He gives them, you know, the much needed rest kind of breaks. Something I wish Coach Pruitt would.
If I'm Julio Jones, I'm like, what the hell's going on, man? We over here talking about, yeah, you taking shots at everybody today. You're talking about the ball.
Just throw jabs at high school.
This is what I mean. I thought, like, getting Julio Jones was supposed to be like, oh, Derrick Henry got to be the main workhorse. We can do other things now. I thought that was the main reason for getting Julio.
Well, and the Titans have essentially bought a bruised banana.
Yeah.
Well, we knew he was old, too. Yeah, that's true.
That Julio trade has to be one of the worst offseason acquisitions.
It makes you almost wish they kept Corey Davis.
Yeah.
I told you that. You said, oh, Julio Jones.
Well, I say this because Julio Jones is different than Corey Davis as far as commanding attention from that defensive secondary.
I think Julio Jones is a different situation, be a different story. It's about the situation.
Yeah, I think he would.
But all I'm saying, I think they're a playoff team. First, they'll host the game. I think they'll win a division. Just because the division's not that great. And that's it. I don't see no real contention.
Okay. So I was like, damn, that's fair. Really quick here, before we go on break, Tony, we're not going to let you escape without talking about this Cowboy game. Ooh, so I hope you're ready for that.
Let's talk about it.
Are you ready? Yes.
Okay, so obviously the Broncos come in at 4-4. They seemingly had their way with the Cowboys, winning 30-16. It was a mixture of running backs between Melvin Gore and Javonte Williams really set the tone for this game. And these young Broncos edge rushers got the pressure on Dak without Tyron Smith. It was Lyle Collins, who looked a little rusty his first game back, and then Terrence Steele, left tackle, which should never happen again. Stick him at right tackle. But Tony, we'll let you get your input first as our Cowboy guy. what were some of your immediate takeaways? And if you're, you know, a fan of the Cowboys, should the people be worried at all or not?
I'm going to address the what went wrong. You kind of actually hit it all. Like, I didn't like whenever they announced that Terrence Steele was going to go to tackle and Lyle would go back to right. I did not like that at all. I was like, the whole purpose of leaving Terrence Steele at right tackle and not promoting Lyle at all was because he's the hot hand. So why the hell did you move? Like, if anything, you put Lyle to the left tackle spot, like, side. I know that's not his forte, but I mean, that's not Terrence Steele's forte either, you know?
Yeah.
And we're finally getting a good play out of Terrence Steele. I'm like, what if this screws up, like, next week? If Tyron comes back this week and he's back at left tackle, what if that throws off Terrence for some reason, you know? You're kind of screwed. So I really dislike that move. It proved it. It proved it right. Like, it was 7 all game. Dak couldn't get the ball off. The run game was just couldn't get going. And the defense suffered. Like, I don't want to blame the defense, because if you watch the beginning of the game, they were playing lights out. That D-line was looking outstanding. But if you looked at the, like, time of possession by, like, the end of the third quarter, the Broncos had the ball for, like, I think 30, like, 5 to, like, 40 minutes, where Dallas had it for 12. Like, you can't leave a defense on the field for nearly an hour. Like, that, of course, like, Denver's going to put up 30 on the defense. I'm not going to play the defense on this one. It was just like I said, it was that O-line issue. So, put Terrence Steele back at right tackle. Hopefully, Tyron comes back. But this is another wake-up call. It's another year where, like, we need to address left tackle. We need to address a backup.
Yeah.
But am I worried? No. Like, we've lost to Tampa Bay Buccaneers and the Denver Broncos. One of those, it's like, oh, it looks bad. It's like, yeah. But, I mean, this week was a perfect example of you can lose at any given moment. You know, we saw the Bills put up a crappy performance. We saw the Rams just not put up, like, not show any life at all. And then I don't want to, like, bash the Saints because, yeah, this was a Trevor Siemian game. But it was the fact that, you know, it was still Atlanta.
Trevor Siemian.
I think New Orleans is still
You lost the Raiders. Why are you, or the Giants, why are you smiling over
we're
there?
We're playing house money. It's okay. We got a rough week.
go on, Tony.
But, yeah, and then we, obviously, Vegas as well. So, like, there was a lot of good teams that lost this week. It's fine. Like, that happens. I mean, Tampa last week, they got curb stomped by New Orleans. So, yeah. I'm not really worried. Like, it happens to the best of the teams. So,
I mean, the Bronco game doesn't necessarily worry me, but going forward, it came out this morning, the Cowboys are going to be without Randy Gregory for what looks like a while with a hamstring injury, and my concern with the Cowboys is, I think this game showed it. If this offense isn't on point and putting up 30 points a game, and you leave this defense out here on the field, which really relies on the turnovers, this defense will get worked. It will get gassed.
Yeah.
I think the lack of linebacker depth is now even more important, because without Gregory at defensive end, DeMarcus Lawrence still is not, you know, doesn't look like he's coming back anytime soon. Do you play Micah at the edge, where he can get the pressure? Are you going to put him? Are you going to leave him a linebacker? And because really, outside of LVE and Micah, who else do you have a linebacker who can come in and play? And I just don't know if this offense is not on point every single week. This defense, it is what it is to me. And that's a below average defense that relies on takeaways. And if you don't get the takeaways, it's not a good unit. Trevon Diggs didn't have a really great game against Minnesota. If you go back and watch the tape. Really, Denver, he had an okay game. I know Tim Patrick worked him for the long touchdown. I thought that was pretty good coverage nonetheless. But you're seeing cracks in this Cowboys team. And I think the Broncos kind of put it out there that if this offense cannot get rolling, you can put up points to beat the Cowboys. But that's just my feeling on this team. I'll throw it to you guys. Javonte, DeAndre, what were some of your thoughts on this?
Well, I mean, I completely agree with your point, Tony, on the offensive line. I think starting Terrence Steele at left tackle, I think one of the reasons why he was, you know, solid at right tackle was because he had a guy like Zach Martin playing next to him that could help him out. You know, you play your two weakest links on the offensive line. Well, I would say Biotish is another weak link, but you play him next to Connor Williams, I don't think that really helps him out or benefits him. So I agree with, you know, I would have started Lael Collins at left tackle, even though he's out of shape. He hasn't played in a while, but, you know, he's familiar playing on that side.
Player.
Yeah, and he's just a player, better player overall. I actually want to ask you, Tony, what went wrong with Dak Prescott? I'm actually wondering what went wrong with that, you know, his level of play that game.
It was just pressure in his face. It was constant pressure and, like, never being able to get in rhythm. Like, it's kind of hard to throw to, like, get these deep balls going whenever you can't even throw 5 yards down, like, down the field because your line is just playing like crap.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, Dak missed a couple of big throws in that game. And to your point, Tony, if you can't get the run game, if you cannot get the run game going with Zeke and Pollard, obviously you can't get the short pass game going, can't get the intermediate pass game going. You really can't get the deep game, the deep ball game going, which is what, you know, CD and Cooper have really excelled at this year, being those deep threats and the home run, you know, plays. It was an ugly game, but I think, you know, that you're due for one of these when you're a good team like the Cowboys. I think they are a good team. I think this is a team that can very, very much still can compete for a Super Bowl. We'll have to wait and see. But before we move on, Javonte, I'll let you get your 2 cents here. Oh. One, did you appreciate the Raider jab? Two, give me some of your thoughts on this Cowboy game.
Well, not the Raiders jab. I've been getting hit with it. My friends have been worried about, oh, you lost to the Giants. I'm like, hey, look, bro, it's a money game, bro. Like, we had a rough week, a lot going on. If we lost,
hey, my friend cut another first round pick.
Yeah, from the same draft class. How about
that? Well, we saw his video. You understand why. But it's been a rough week. I'm telling you, it's crazy. But as far as we won the game, like, oh, they won. Adversity doesn't stop this team. But, you know, we lost the game. It is what it is. We bounced back. I don't know. It started to look rough, though. It started to get every week I'm starting to get worried. Whenever I see some Raiders notification pop up, somewhere, somebody got cut, somebody been arrested, something like that. I'm starting to worry a lot. probably the Cowboy game, I agree with everything Tony and you, all y'all said. Honestly, y'all made good points. I think the defense isn't built to. I think this defense is built based off this offense. This offense has to put up points, and if the offense put up points, the defense can play the game where they reach for turnovers, go for turnovers. Like Trayvon Diggs has been going for turnovers all year. When that ain't happening, you know, there's some problems sometimes. But I mean, as far as the team getting down early, you're expecting your defense to hold you over, and that's just not fair to that defense, especially with a team that's built off this offense being so powerful. So I agree with everything y'all said. I'm not worried about the Cowboys. I think they'll be fine. It's a weird game because they got gashed. It's like, I'm kind of crazy to see them in Dallas. I didn't expect them to lose this game. But,
yeah.
You know, I think they'll have a chance to bounce back. You know, schedule is kind of interesting, though.
I'm not worried about Dallas winning the division because, let's face it, like, division's already won. Like, you know, they could lose, you know, half their remaining schedule. I still don't think anyone's going to catch them in that division race. It's just that bad. And I am concerned, though, when they get into playoffs, when they play a team like Green Bay or the Rams, you know, because that defense is starting to show cracks, like you mentioned, how, like, it's looked good early on in the season, but that's because they benefit off those turnovers. But, you know, and one of the keys to exploiting that Dallas defense is attacking down the field, because they're great playing coverage underneath, you know, within the first 15 yards. But if you attack down the field, you know, that's one way to break them.
Yeah, Belichick showed that with the Kendrick Bourne touchdown, I thought. And then the Vikings early on with Jefferson, they got a couple of nice deep balls on Diggs. And then
A.B., didn't he go crazy?
Yeah.
And then Denver with Tim Patrick, who had the long touchdown. And I thought that was still good coverage by Diggs. But,
yeah.
I mean, nonetheless, I think the Cowboys are fine. It's just a matter of getting healthy on the offensive line with Tyron Smith. And it looks like he might not play this week. We'll wait and see what happens there.
That schedule is kind of interesting, though, just come weeks with the Raiders. I think it's about to be a good game, actually. And then you got the Raiders, you got the Chiefs.
Hey, can I already?
Or Chiefs, Raiders, you got a couple.
I already have
Saints
a prediction.
Saints.
I already have one prediction, specific prediction. Because, you know, the Raiders recently signed Deshaun Jackson to replace Henry Ruggs as that deep threat down the field.
Correct, Odell Beckham.
Raiders play Cowboys Thanksgiving. I'm going to predict their RA. Deshaun Jackson is going to catch a deep touchdown pass in AT&T Stadium for like the third or fourth time already in his career.
I dig it.
Yep.
Miles will drop the ball before he gets to the end zone.
Yep. And drop the ball before he gets to the
end zone. No, as long as you don't do that part, we're good.
All right, really quick here, guys, before we take a break. Let's do some mid-season-ish, because technically it was 17 games. kind of is maybe not maybe the halfway point. Let's dive into some midseason awards. These are from NFL.com. They have MVP, Offensive Defensive Player of the Year, Offensive Defensive Rookie of the Year, Comeback Player of the Year, and then Coach of the Year. They have a bunch of dudes and women casting their votes for their midseason awards. So let's start with MVP. Tony, who do you think is your midseason MVP right now?
I'm probably going to have to go with, yeah, Kyler, just because it's, you know. But, like, my only issue is, like, he's had that one game against Green Bay. Not really his fault either, but it was just not that great of a game. Got hurt this week, and Arizona still found a way to win and, like, pummel the Niners. I'm not saying that's necessarily a big negative.
No,
I'm saying I am scrutinizing that to an extent when it comes to the end of the year, and it's like a tight race. But Kyler right now is still probably going to be my MVP.
If it's because Colt McCoy played, Colt McCoy is the best. We all know it. He's the best backup in the NFL.
No, it's James Conner. Is that dude?
Yeah, you could say it's James Conner who carried that game. But DeAndre Javante, who do you think your midseason-ish MVP is right now?
I'm going to go with the guy we're playing tonight, Lamar Jackson.
Okay.
I think he's my MVP pick. I mean, you look at – I mean, Kyler is close, but Lamar is the Ravens' offense. You know, you look at a guy who's leading the team in rushing yards, passing yards, and you look back at those games, I think he's just had more of those moments, you know, those game-winning moments. We look at the game versus Detroit, that pass converted on fourth down. That run, he had a two-point conversion he had against Kansas City, I believe, where it was a touchdown against Kansas City. We look at that game in overtime versus Indianapolis, and then we look at this week versus Minnesota. Like, he's just made so many game-changing plays, you know, so many big game moments, you know, so I think that's something that you have to take into consideration with the MVP race, so he's my MVP right now.
All right, Javante, who are you feeling?
Tom Brady. Numbers look good. He's not missing games. They're winning still. I mean, they had that Saints game, but besides that, they've been winning. I'm going to go Tom Brady, man. Every other quarterback, you can see, like y'all name, like Kyler Murray has, and Aaron Rodgers, of course, could have been there, but, you know, Lamar Jackson. So I'm going to go Tom Brady, just, you know, Tom Brady. Lots of us there. Yeah.
So NFL.com, they currently have Tom Brady as their MVP right now.
I did not see this list, guys.
I think for me, I would go with Lamar, and that's just because the fashion, the way these Ravens are winning games this year, it's not with Lamar running the ball or the team, this team in general running the football. It's him throwing the football.
Well, that's okay. We could have brought in Justin Tucker.
I mean, he's good, but it's impressive. It's impressive to see what Lamar has done.
He's playing better. He's gotten better this year, or since last year.
Granted, he has the 2015 Pro Bowl roster as his running backs.
Yeah, and the Ravens, they've been hit with injuries in that offensive line as well. And that, like, you look at him versus Kyler and Tom, like, Kyler and Tom, I think, have better defenses right now than Baltimore's.
They've been a very big letdown this year, defensively. Okay, Offensive Player of the Year, Tony, who do you have?
Man, that one's tough just because, like, all these candidates that we've, like, seen have been, like, kind of disappointing here and there. But I think Cooper Kupp is still, like, on his way to, like, I think he's, like, still has a big enough cushion to, like, have these games every once in a while.
Yeah, I agree. I think my vote would also go to Cooper Kupp. I think he's been phenomenal this year. And I believe if he keeps it up, he's on record to break almost every receiving record in a single season. And that might not be even with the 17th game. He's been fun to watch. I think Cooper Kupp would get my vote.
Yeah. Hey, I'm going to make it three. I think Cooper Kupp as well. That man's right now has like 970 receiving yards. He's on pace to have 2,000 receiving yards by the end of the season. So I think it's amazing for him. So he's my pick.
Yeah, I'm curious if Odell Beckham coming in, but I'm going to go with Kupp also. You can go with the sweep. I'll go with Kupp.
Oh, okay. Check us out. Going with the sweep. Okay.
I tried to think somebody else. I couldn't think of it. I was like.
NFL.com, their offensive player of the year is Cooper Kupp. They have behind him Matt Stafford, Tom Brady, Kyler Murray, Devontae Adams, Nick Chubb, Lamar Jackson, and Dak Prescott all at least got one vote. Mm-hmm. So those are the guys. Defensive player of the year. Now, I'm interested to see where we go in this direction. Tony, who do you have?
There's a lot of candidates for this one. Like, there's a lot of defenses that have been stepping up this year. Like, they just looked a lot better than last year. And I have it down to two people. They're both in the AFC. It's either going to be Myles Garrett or T.J. Watt. Like, T.J. Watt is, like, after seeing that game, he is still that dude. It's crazy to see him, like, just get to the quarterback nonstop.
Mm-hmm. I think for me, I'm going to go with T.J. Watt as well. As Tony mentioned, that Monday night game from Chicago, I think it showed you that he is, you know, he is the reason this defense is where it's at. And, you know, he could very easily help get the Steelers team to the playoffs. And I think if they don't have T.J. Watt, they're not even in the talk right now for a wild card spot. He's been absolutely fun to watch. Currently at 11.5 sacks, 3 forced fumbles. There's few words to describe T.J. Watt and how great he's been this year. So he's been fun to watch. He get my vote.
Nice. Yeah, I'm gonna go with Myles Garrett, man. I think he's at this point where, you know, he's averaging about 1.5 sacks per game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think he's going to be a 20-sack guy this year. Look at him as a guy who's been dominating in years past. Now you've got a guy like Clowney who plays opposite of him, and some, you know, that you strengthen that secondary. So, you know, I think he's going to be a guy that's going to get a lot of sats by the end of this year. Probably, I mean, he might be edged close to that Michael Strahan record, or, you know, that Aaron Donald, Michael Strahan type.
Dig it.
Yeah. Guy, I'm going with. I see a lot of my TL just because Celtic fans. So I see a lot of him. It's gonna be Matthew Judon.
Really
underrated.
Yeah. Really,
I'm going with him, bro. And I see him on my TL all the time. People love talking about him, and he's dominant. I like watching him play. I told you, I was like, I'm surprised y'all trying to get him in the offseason.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's a really good player. I really enjoy watching him. I think he's gonna. I'm picking him. And his team's winning games. I'm picking him. And defense has been amazing over in New England. So.
Okay. I like that. That's not even on this list. They have Myles Garrett is their predicted defensive player of the year. Then it's Trevon Diggs, Aaron Donald, T.J. Watt, Kevin Byard, Max Crosby, and Jalen Ramsey. I dig it. All right. I thought this one should be a sweep. Offensive rookie of the year.
Oh, they want to put yours out there. Jerry Judy.
Oh, Jalen Watt.
No. Oh, Jerry Watt. I said Jerry Judy, Jalen Watt. Jalen Watt.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's got to be Ja'Marr Chase. He's doing things that we've been seeing a receiver do his first league since Randy Moss. And that's saying something. Because last year, his teammate, Justin Jefferson, had set the bar for rookie receiver play.
LSU receiver, they put on.
And now Ja'Marr Chase is going to obliterate that to a whole other level. He's been fun to watch.
Yeah, I don't think there's anyone close to Ja'Marr Chase. Jalen Waddle's nice, don't get me wrong, leads rookie receivers in catches, but, you know, he doesn't have the right coaching or offense to explode like Chase. So, but Chase, you know, he's a guy, like you mentioned, now going to break a lot of records. I think, you know, the first half, he's going to, like, I think the second half will be, you know, lesser statistics than the first half. I think defenses will kind of adjust to him by the end of the season, so he won't break out. He won't have those big games like he had in the first half of the season. But I still think overall he's going to have some very good numbers for a rookie receiver in the NFL. So he's my pick.
I take it.
Yeah, I'm with Ja'Marr Chase. Also, I think like you said, the statistics have been crazy. I think also I guess I can make an argument for. I guess at first it was like, oh, nobody can make an argument. But I guess. If Mac Jones makes the playoffs and keep playing solid, he could have a chance to win it.
No, not after that against Brian Burns.
I'll throw your other name out there, I think, who could maybe be
in contention. Don't steal mine.
Okay, Tyler, go ahead then, Tyler. You, is it a different guy?
It's not Ja'Marr, no.
It's not Mac Jones?
Nope.
I think I know who it's going to be, so. Go ahead and spin it out.
It's Najee Harris.
I like that pick.
Pittsburgh is a crappy team, if we're going to be honest. We're looking up and down their roster. It looks like straight crappy. It's outside of, like, Hayward and T.J. Watt.
And the offensive line.
Everything else is kind of crappy. But Najee has made that offense, like, somewhat valuable. Like, Big Ben doesn't look like total garbage because all he has to do is throw, like, 2 yards to Najee, and Najee will, like, at least get him a first down.
Yeah.
and they just take the clock away from teams, you know? That I think that's the only reason Pittsburgh is somewhat relevant is because it's all Najee.
Yeah. I mean, if the Steelers were to maybe get on a run here and make a postseason run, I think it's going to be by feeding Najee Harris. Then I think at that point, if they do get into the postseason, you do have the conversation to make of how important Najee Harris is to the Steelers, yeah. And should he be worthy of Rookie of the Year.
And I would say, I would agree with you, Tony. It's one of those things where you kind of look at statistics versus on-field production. Like, if you were watching both those rookies closely in those games, you could probably say Najee makes a bigger impact than Ja'Marr Chase because, you know, the Bengals, they have a stacked receiving core in Tyler Boyd and T. Higgins, and they have Joe Mixon in the backfield. Najee, like as you mentioned, is that Pittsburgh offense, especially right now with the fact that they lost Juju for the year. They're playing without Chase Claypool. So I think based on impact alone, I agree Najee has been making the most impact for that Steelers team.
It should be like last year when Herbert won the award, but I think people thought Jefferson should have won Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, quarterbacks always get the love.
Yeah, no. But not this year. They're all trash. Except hey. Justin Fields. He's not.
Yeah. Can Justin Fields make a late run for Rookie of the Year?
If the Bears fire Matt Nagy, he has a chance. Or if the refs just call penalties right.
Yeah.
And really quick, taunting. It needs to be.
Oh, that rule needs to be eradicated.
Yeah, that needs to be eradicated faster than you can say personal foul, taunting.
Yeah, it's terrible.
It's terrible.
It's making a sad. It's sad. It's really destroying. You know, as far as the viewership for the game, because you're like you're watching the NFL, you're thinking this fun game, but it's the
fun. It caught the no fun league.
Yeah, that's all I'm about to say. Yeah, but it's now the
like,
no fun
you know,
league.
Like action pack, hard hitting, like football.
Yeah. I'm not disagreeing. I'm just saying, I get what you're saying. But
you know.
This is what the NFL is now.
That's what I'm saying.
Hard hitting. What's hard hitting?
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
What do you mean hard hitting? Shit,
I know.
We're not back in no fun.
If you told Sean Taylor that, yeah, he probably would question, like, what the hell do you mean? No flag. What do you mean? What is targeting?
Like, what do you mean I can hit a play? What do you mean I can hit a receiver in the air as he's going up for a ball?
Exactly. It's different.
Like, what do you mean I can't lay out a punter in the Pro Bowl?
Yeah, like, you know, it's crazy because it's like, we've seen that. We've seen the whole targeting rule, how that's changed. And I get that because of the level of, you know, concussions and all that. Like, I see why we make those changes. I understand that. But the whole taunting penalty and, you know, like, that's just...
You gotta do it for the views, bro, the viewership.
Yeah.
How is that
for the older viewers that don't like that stuff?
Yeah.
Man.
Think about the NFL has, like, an older... Like, NFL base, but like, older fan bases, too. Like, people are, like, 70 years old.
Well, I do think that's one reason, but I think the main reason that they were going for it is because they want less on-field fighting or anything to take place in the games. Like, they think of that as a reason that, because, you know, that's a big instigator in starting a brawl.
It was the Tyreek Hill thing that he did. Just get the gloves and have words or something. I don't know.
But yeah.
It is suck, though. It takes away from the game. Especially when you're just getting hyped for getting a first down or something like that.
Yeah. I mean, it's just...
Yeah, it is what it is. Lastly here, guys. Defensive Rookie of the Year, Comeback Player of the Year. I feel like it's kind of unanimous here with us. My Rookie of the Year defensively, it's got to be Micah Parsons. It's so rare to find a player who can excel as a pass coverage linebacker and then at the same time he put his hands on the ground and rush against premium tackles. I know everybody wanted the Cowboys to take us a corner, and Surtain has been very nice this year as well, but Micah Parsons might be just one of those generational Khalil Mack type guys, because that was the comparison coming out of high school for Parsons, was the next Khalil Mack, and I think now we're getting a taste of it in the NFL, because he might be better as a prospect than Khalil Mack coming out of Buffalo, because Khalil Mack was that guy as a pass rusher, but you're seeing Parsons, he can rush,
he can do it all,
he can cover, he can play the run, he can play the pass, do whatever you ask him to, and he might be just one of those generational type talents.
I don't know about that. I agree with you on that. I'm a Micah Parsons.
Yeah. So
same here. Yeah, I know. Once I saw Micah Parsons ran a 4.44 at Penn State Pro Day, I was like, yeah, this guy's winning Rookie of the Year.
Yeah,
there ain't no question about it.
Whoever drafts him's gonna be lucky. Tony, I'm sure you're feeling the same vibes here, aren't you?
Yeah, and I completely forgot. I thought about it the other day. It was like, you know what's crazy is that, like, I remember, like, people freaking out over Micah Parsons Pro Day. And I was like, wow, whoever gets him is going to be great. You know, I was like, I'm fine with Patrick Surtain, though. And it's like, oh, well, thank God we got Micah Parsons now. Like, I get to, like, look back and be like, damn, we kind of lucked out and got this guy.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things where it's, like, it's kind of surprising that Parsons was even on the board for Dallas at pick number, what was it, 12?
Yeah.
Something like that. So, I mean, that's just amazing. Amazing, amazing find there. I mean, look, hey, you look at those concerns, those character concerns that he had at Penn State, I still would have took him running with a 4.440 with that size.
Yeah.
If I had to put him in a separate locker room, I'm fine with that. I'm choosing him.
The Duke and ball.
Yeah, Duke and ball, man.
And lastly, comeback player of the year, I feel like, again, this is going to be Dak Prescott's name written all over it, as it should be. He's played at a, he's back at a, playing at an extremely high level. It's going to be Dak. We all know it.
That's tough.
I'm saying Joe Burrow.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's a tough one.
Stop.
I'm going to say Joe Burrow.
Stop. DeAndre, just stop.
I'm just being
honest. I'm just going based on what people are going to look at. People are going to look at the whole picture. Dallas Cowboys, NFC East. You know, Joe Burrow's, I mean, I get he lost last week to Cleveland. But I'm saying Joe Burrow, you know, doing things we didn't expect. You were buying in on the Bengals. You were buying in. You know what I mean? So I think they're Joe Burrow.
Yeah, I'll say this. I think by the end of the year, it probably will be Dak Prescott, but it's not a sure thing right now to me. I think if the Bengals are able to rebound and recover and go back to that slate that they had those current, you know, first 7 weeks of the season, I think Joe Burrow might win it just based on the fact that, as Javonte mentioned, they play in a tough AFC North division, whereas Dallas, that's NFC East.
They're expected to be trash this year. We expect them to be with the Dolphins on.
Well, damn, you didn't have to throw that out there.
Oh, but okay. I didn't get real. We expected that. We played two wins.
Okay.
But, no, yeah, I appreciate you understanding my side of that.
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, no hate.
Tony, I'm sure me and you are on the same page, though, correct?
Yeah, I just have a quick question. How many MVP votes does Joe Burrow have? Did he have any votes?
Oh, no. He's coming for you, too, right now.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I'm saying if that's considered for MVP, then I feel like comeback is kind of like he's had that long.
He can't probably get sent to Joe Burrow. He's my MVP. Does that count?
Dak Prescott, your MVP?
No, Joe Burrow. He's my vote.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Of course he's yours with your fantasy team.
Do what?
I said, of course, Joe Burrow is your favorite because of fantasy.
Hey, Jovid is a very creative team name.
Pull up Joe Burrow's numbers versus Dak numbers. I'm pretty sure they're about the same. I don't see why Joe Burrow doesn't get MVP. I mean, I consider it probably because he plays for the Cincinnati.
It's because he's in Cincinnati.
Yeah,
that's
he plays
why.
In Cincinnati. So that's my argument for why Joe Burrow isn't in the MVP discussion.
Let me see. Joe Burrow threw 9 games, 68 completion percentage, 2,497 yards, 20 touchdowns, 11 interceptions. Dak, and keep in mind Dak is 1 game less because of the injury. Dak's numbers include 69.4 completion percentage, 2,045 yards, 18 touchdowns, 5 interceptions. So those are the numbers for the two.
Okay.
So, yeah. So you think it's Dak, Tony, right?
Yup.
No explanation. okay, guys. So instead of pick 'em flick 'em this week, we're having a little fun here on the show. Well, more fun than we normally do. It's not March yet, but it's a tradition on this show. When March Madness hits, our bracket's going flying out left and right. Today, I decided to pull one out early with Disney Plus Day dropping tomorrow. All the content coming out. The four of us are, I guess, what you would classify as nerds. But we're cool nerds. We're sport cool nerds.
Yep.
I have an MCU bracket of all the movies.
Oh, man.
So we're going to go through this real quick. However, I am taking out two movies and replacing them with Black Widow and Shang-Chi.
Okay.
Taking out the Hulk.
And I'm guessing Thor, The Dark World?
Yeah. How'd you know? The two worst movies.
You know, lucky guess.
Okay, so, Tony, are you game with this?
Yeah.
Okay, let's roll. Let's do it then. Starting off, this bracket that I did not steal from the internet. I made her myself totally originally. I'm just staring at the computer just because. It has the one seeds, one and two seeds are on buys, I guess, if you will, so the crappier ones are duking it out. Starting we have Ant-Man and Black Widow.
Ant-Man. I'm going to give that one to Ant-Man.
Yeah, I think I'm going to go with Ant-Man as well.
Okay, I'm going to be the one that picks Black Widow then. It's a losing fight, but hey, I give some respect to Scarlett Johansson.
No, I like Scarlett Johansson. I prefer Ant-Man.
Ant-Man's a better movie.
It's just hard to pick Black Widow because it's like, it's a movie where you see this character and you know that she's not going anywhere after.
Yeah.
You know?
It's a flashback type. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. That's true. It's a good way. It's a good way of looking at it. Is that what you do on the videos, DeAndre?
Yeah, of course.
You go beyond death.
Yes, always.
Yeah, plug it in real quick. Yeah.
Before Javante, you know, always gotta say something.
Okay, up next we have Captain America, the First Avenger, and Doctor Strange.
Damn, that's tough.
Give me Doctor Strange on that one.
Yeah, Tony's a big Strange guy. This is hard for me.
I really watched Captain America, the First Avenger the other day.
The First Avenger is so underrated.
It's not my favorite. It's kind of boring, but it's a great story. I'm going to Doctor Strange also. Doctor Strange actually wasn't my favorite when I first watched it in theaters. It grew on me after I watched it a couple more times.
Okay.
I'm going to Doctor Strange though.
DeAndre, what are you thinking?
Yeah, I think I'm going to go Doctor Strange as well.
Cap will get some more love. I know he'll get some love later.
Yeah, trust me.
He'll get some love later on.
Yeah, Doctor Strange, it just, there was so much new aspects brought to the MCU with that movie, so that's why it's one of my picks. I'll pick it over, the First Avenger.
I'll be the same guy again. I'll pick the First Avenger.
You want to be
just put some respect on these movies. up next, Spider-Man Homecoming and Iron Man 3.
Oh, damn. This should be an easy one. I'm going to choose Spider-Man Homecoming.
Spider-Man Homecoming.
Right, that's an easy one for me. I'll go Iron Man 3. I watched that.
Oh my god, what is wrong with you?
Iron Man 3, I know it's not great, it's not the best movie, it's not the best Iron Man movie either, but I like Spider Man Homecoming. Damn.
You going Iron Man 3?
I'll go Iron Man 3.
Tony, what are you thinking?
I'm gonna go Iron Man 3.
Hey,
that's what we're gonna do then. Just for the
Iron Man 3 was still fun, in my opinion.
Thank you, Tony.
Okay,
so this is what we're gonna do. Rock, paper, scissors.
Oh my
god. DeAndre Javante.
For which one stays in?
Yeah.
Alright,
for a true battle of champions.
I shoot? Okay. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Gotcha.
Damn.
Iron 3 staying.
Yeah, it's okay, John.
Bye, Spider-Man.
We still far from home in this bracket. It's okay.
Okay.
Okay, now moving on to the other side of the bracket, we have Thor and Avengers Age of Ultron.
Age of Ultron. Oh, we're Thor 1, right?
This is the first Thor?
Yeah, first Thor.
Okay, yeah, Age of Ultron.
Age of Ultron also.
Yeah, I'm going to go Age of Ultron.
Me and Tony have been on this whole rant that Age of Ultron gets criminally hated.
It does, yeah.
It's a great movie. I love it.
You ever heard Josh Bean talk about it? He literally said, like, he felt so much pressure to come off of Avengers 1. He felt so much pressure making that movie.
I'll say right now, I like Age of Ultron more than the first Avengers.
I think Ultron was cool, but I think, like, Ultron lacks so many things I want to see.
Well, no, he neutered Ultron. Ultron was neutered in the movie.
Yeah, for sure.
As we've seen in What If. That man was neutered.
I believe Age of Ultron is definitely the worst Avengers movie, but I don't see why people...
I don't think it's the worst, but...
No.
We'll
talk about it later. Well, I mean... But,
oh, damn. Okay.
Well, but I don't see why people put it as one of the worst MCU movies when it's clearly not.
Because the rest has... most of us that compared to is like bangers, that's why.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, up next, Guardians of the Galaxy 2 and Shang-Chi Legend of the Ten Rings.
Shang-Chi. If it was Guardians 1, it would got the lid, but Guardians 2, I'll take Shang-Chi.
Yeah, I'm going to take Shang-Chi as well.
I prefer Guardians 1 or Guardians 2.
Yeah, give me Shang-Chi.
The choreography.
Yeah, I didn't. I'm a bad Marvel fan. I didn't see it.
I haven't seen it
yet.
Oh, it's amazing.
Well, Tony, you have a chance. It comes to Disney Plus November 12th. So, this Friday, be sure to glue your eyes to that TV as you watch it.
And if you want a non-spoiler review, just check out Dre and Jay's YouTube channel for the little preview.
There you go. Shang-Chi had a great origin story.
It is.
Character. And it had great choreography and stuff. So, y'all go Shang-Chi.
Yeah. Okay. I'm interested in this one. Up next, Ant-Man and the Wasp and Captain Marvel.
The worst of two evils.
give me
the Guardian.
give me
Ant-Man the Wasp. Oh, Ant-Man the Wasp. Ant-Man the Wasp.
Give me Ant-Man the Wasp.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, Ant-Man the Wasp. I'm gonna
agree. I'd take Captain Marvel. Yeah, I'm crazy. I'd take Captain Marvel in a heartbeat.
Sheesh.
Damn.
Okay. Oh, okay. The last one for the first round here. Spider-Man Far From Home and Iron Man 2. I'll just say this. For the sake of Iron Man 2, gave us the greatest characters in the MCU. It introduces Nick Fury. It introduces Black Widow. And the crown jewel of them all, it gives us Don Cheadle's War Machine.
Oh, yeah, War Machine.
It gives us Don Cheadle in the MCU, and it got rid of the man.
It's like easy to know what you're picking.
Iron Man 2.
Yeah.
Iron Man 2's got my vote. I'll
go Iron Man 2 also.
Yeah, I'm going to agree. Iron Man 2.
And the crazy thing.
This is the upset.
Yeah, I just don't. Spider-Man, the MCU, I'm not that big of a fan of. It was great in Civil War, and then I just kind of. The movies have kind of been underwhelming.
They couldn't get me back, don't worry.
Is it because he's Tony Stark Jr.?
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
That's fair. Tony?
Yeah, but I'm with you on it. Iron Man 2.
Whoa, sweep! I'm not a Spider-Man fan like that. I know people love Spider-Man. I'm not really crazy about Spider-Man like that.
Okay, now you just lost.
I think Spider-Man's the most overhyped MCU character.
See, me and Tony on the same page, bro. I think Spider-Man's
the most overhyped. That's probably
I know why people love him, but
it's not that like he's the greatest MCU. It's just that he's been through so many, like...
His story
arcs. You've seen him animated TV shows. You had the 90s. Movie, I believe, and then you have Tobey Maguire, you have Andrew Garfield, so
and video games too.
Yeah, he's been the most transcendent Marvel character.
He's the biggest Marvel character.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I guess the difference is that Tom Holland's Spider-Man is like almost in no way similar to any other adaptation of Spider-Man that we've seen.
Yeah,
he's always been the standalone, friendly neighborhood, I do my own thing guy, and now he's, and people will call him Iron Man Jr.
Well, also part of the problem, he don't keep the damn mask on. That's also a problem. Tom Holland always takes the goddamn mask off every five.
Also, it pisses me off how he just gave away Edith to Mysterio. Yeah. It just pisses
me
off.
I just hate how he's always like, man, I just want to go to high school. I want to do that. Like, motherfucker, you Spider-Man, dog. I'm not saving people, dog.
He wanted to be Avenger. He wanted to be Avenger the first movie that he realized, oh, shit, this shit got real up here with the Thanos.
But, you know, after Far From Home, like, I get, like,
half. He died, bro.
Yeah, he died. And, like, I get that, like, oh, like, you never know which moment's gonna be your last, but, like, damn, like, half the world got snapped by, like, Thanos, like, I gotta be on alert, man, I gotta make sure I'm protecting everybody, and so it never happens.
And you know what? He got fooled by Nick Fury and Marie Hill, because they weren't even the real Fury and Hill.
Yeah,
they were Skrulls.
Like, man, where's your spider senses at?
Peter Tingle.
Oh, my God, I am.
But, we can all agree, though, Spider-Man, No Way Home?
I'm gonna say right now, you can put Spider-Man No Way Home in this list, and I definitely pick that over some movie right now, just based on hype.
Okay, alright, moving on to the second round here. Oh god, Avengers Endgame and Ant-Man.
And Ant-Man?
Yeah. Poor Paul Rudd.
Well, I'm gonna say right now, I'm not that big of a fan of Endgame. I think Endgame's a thing. I don't think Endgame's all that great, but I'll go Endgame over Ant-Man. I'm not crazy.
Damn. Okay.
I'll go with Endgame as well.
When Endgame hits a heavy hitter though, it gonna get that wrath.
Yeah. Endgame, just so much emotion in that movie, so that's why it's I'll choose that over Ant-Man.
Yeah. Tony.
Oh, I didn't hear you. Somebody. Yeah. Endgame.
Yeah.
Another sweep.
Oh, okay, that's gonna be a fun one.
A sweep.
Black Panther and Iron Man.
Black Panther! I love Iron Man 2. I love Iron Man. I love Black Panther. I love both those films. I gave Iron Man 2 victories. I'm gonna go Black Panther. Black Panther also was something different for me. First time seeing it and stuff like that. I saw this movie six times at the theater. I'm gonna go with Black Panther. That's a big shout out to Bozeman.
I'll do you one better. I saw it 7 times in the theater.
Nice. I respect that.
Yep.
You were Black Panther that one year for Halloween.
Yes, I was.
I'll go Black Panther. I'm with Black Panther.
All right, Tony, what are you thinking?
I'm gonna go Iron Man just because that was like I remember being a kid watching that and like growing up with Iron Man. That was my dude.
That's a tough one. I like Iron Man also the first one. So I mean that
started everything too.
Yeah.
I want to put this rock paper scissors. No, you know, give me a Black Panther. I'll pick Black Panther. It's a transcendent film, and no matter what happens, it's going to run over by
anything. And no lie, Black Panther probably had one of the coolest, probably one of the most unique, difficult to understand villains. But he got his motivation by
Killmonger.
Beyond. But
I will say this though, Iron Man. You look at as far as from like a film perspective, like it's more realistic because of like the less CGI that Black Panther. And I understand that. It's because of time. So that's why Iron Man, like, it's more natural of a movie to me when I watch it compared to Black Panther. But, again, like, Black Panther, I just...
That's your boy.
Yeah, that's my boy.
That's your movie right there.
Yep.
Up next, Captain America, Civil War, and Doctor Strange.
Civil War, all day. That's pretty much like an Avenger movie, but Civil War.
Yeah, Civil War.
That's probably one of my favorites. I watch that like all the time.
Yeah. That trailer is like the most like crap your pants moment in the history of movies.
Yeah, and it was so crazy. They dropped that BVS right before that. BVS came out like, oh, BVS, oh, and then they dropped that Captain America Civil War.
And we all know which one's better.
We all know which one's better.
Batman vs. Superman, right?
No, the deluxe edition, yeah.
Yeah, the ultimate edition.
Tony, what are you thinking?
It was between, what was it again? I'm sorry.
Strange and Civil War.
Yeah, it's Civil War.
Yeah. Okay then. Iron Man 3 and Captain America Winter Soldier.
Winter Soldier. Yeah, that's not enough for debate. This is Winter Soldier.
It's gotta be Winter Soldier.
So eventually we knew Gonzaga would run into little UNT.
Yeah.
It was eventually going to happen.
Oh,
Tony, you're on the same page?
Yep.
Okay, then. Alrighty, then. On the other side of the bracket now, Infinity War, Age of Ultron.
Infinity War.
Infinity War. That's where you see all the characters come from together from all different Marvel movies. So, yeah, got to go with Infinity War.
Infinity War.
You know, Age of Ultron had the better Hulk, but yeah.
Oh, yeah. We don't talk about that.
Okay, then. Up next, Guardians of the Galaxy 1 versus Shang-Chi.
Damn it.
This is hard.
It's hard, man.
John, did you say if it was the first Guardians who would have taken it?
Guardians Galaxy 2 and Shang-Chi.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Tell you, hey, thank you for checking me. Guardians won the victory.
You got the receipts for me. Tell you, fact check.
Hey, I really like Shang-Chi, though, too, but Guardians, I think Guardians won. Guardians was unique, but I've never seen Guardians. I'm like, who are these guys? And why? Yeah. Like, this is pretty cool. They had a nice music, James Gunn and stuff. Tight.
Yeah.
I think Shang-Chi's kind of in the same realm as, like, unknown, lesser known Marvel characters.
Mm-hmm.
But Guardians was the first one to do it and do it at such a high level.
Yeah.
And all those characters are so beloved. Groot, Rocket. Yeah.
Guardians of the Galaxy, it had that team dynamic that Shang-Chi. Yeah. I mean, Shang-Chi does have a bit of that team dynamic with his sister, and, you know, obviously.
It's not the same, though.
Yeah, it's not the same.
They're a bunch of misfits and
putting together. Yeah. But, yeah, that's why I like Guardians more. And that James Gunn, the soundtrack, everything.
Yeah.
Just love it.
I'll go Guardians of the Galaxy. What do you think? What do you got, Tony?
Yeah, Guardians.
I mean, he's going to say that. He's never even seen Shang-Chi. But.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Okay, Thor Ragnarok, Ant-Man and the Wasp.
I'll go Thor Ragnarok.
Ragnarok.
Okay, then. We have Spider-Man Far From Home and The Avengers.
The first Avengers?
Iron Man 2 and The Avengers. Oh, I bet. Okay. First Avengers, yeah.
The first Avengers?
Yeah.
Oh, first Avengers all day. That is the best Avengers movie right there.
Yeah. What do you got, Tony?
I'll take Avengers.
All right, I'll take Iron Man 2.
Damn.
That's a ship I'll go down dying on.
Okay.
Right. I stand on Cheadle.
Alright, hey. It's been an honor playing with you guys. Cue the Titanic music for Alec.
There's room for all you on my wooden plank.
Nah, we're good.
There's room for...
Nah, we're good.
my wooden plank clearly has enough room for all of you, but I just choose not to let you on my wooden plank.
Yeah.
I never understood that in the Titanic.
Why? All right, that door was too. I think wasn't it a door?
Yeah.
There
was room for you to at least hang on.
And even not for just him, but there were plenty of other dead bodies in the ocean that were hanging on to like doors. I would have just like moved one of those bodies off. And
like, why do you just let go and drown, my guy?
Jack chose death, bro. I'm telling you, he did not want to get tied.
This is why Leo never won an Oscar for like 20 years.
Yeah.
It's poor acting. Everyone knows you would just grab onto something. Okay. oh god. Okay. Avengers Endgame, Black Panther.
Damn.
This is hard.
I'm gonna go Endgame.
I know it's gonna lose, but I'm going Black Panther. I know it's gonna lose though.
So I know DeAndre might. He might be on your.
Yeah, go Endgame.
That is tough, bro. Cause like, damn.
I'm gonna go Endgame.
Okay.
It 23 years of Marvel, or how long is it? No, 23. Like 10 years of Marvel films led up to that.
Yeah.
And just the whole battle scene at the end, that you can't beat that.
Yeah, I gotta go Endgame. Just it's just nostalgia. It goes back, and especially with the time travel, it goes back to all those other former like Marvel movies. Mm-hmm. So I think you gotta give it credit for that. So
bye, Black Panther.
Yeah. Goodbye. See you in there.
Sweet Prince.
Yeah.
Okay. Civil War and the Winter Soldier.
Ooh, it's tough.
It's tough.
I know Civil War though. That's tough. Where's Civil War? Yeah, that's a tough one. Go Civil War.
I'm gonna go Civil War.
Okay. What do you think, DeAndre?
Yeah, I think I'm gonna go Civil War as well. That was a tough one.
Again, Civil War was the most crap my pants moment in the history of movie trailers. To see Black Panther and then to see Spider-Man.
Yeah. Oh yeah, Spider-Man. Yeah.
You couldn't beat that. There's no like, oh my god, moment in the history of trailers.
Yeah. Imagine if we did trailer reality.
Infinity War got me almost there. That first Infinity War trailer, when it first dropped the first ever trailer, it got me there close.
Yeah.
I was ready to buy tickets right there and there.
Okay then, so on the left side we'll have Endgame and Civil War. And let's finish up the right side here. We have Infinity War and Guardians of the Galaxy.
So wait, that's
Infinity
the final
War.
Four?
Nah,
that's two. That's side. Two of the final four.
Yeah, okay. Infinity War for me.
I'll go with Infinity War as well.
It's between Infinity War and who?
Guardians.
Oh yeah, Infinity War.
I'm gonna go Infinity War, but it's closer than people think.
That's true. That's fair. Okay, Thor Ragnarok and the Avengers.
Avengers. Sorry, Ragnarok has to happen. With the Avengers movie.
This is your Ragnarok.
Okay. I'm gonna go Avengers too. I'm gonna go Avengers.
Yeah,
like, you know, Avengers. That's
what I mean. What do you think, Tony?
I'll go with Avengers.
Alright, I'm gonna go with the Avengers as well.
Ooh, nice.
Alright, so your final four include Avengers Endgame, Avengers Infinity War, Captain America Civil War, and the Avengers.
Pretty much all Avenger movies made it.
Yeah, we consider Captain America Civil
pretty
War.
Pretty much, yeah, okay.
Alright. Endgame and Civil War.
Civil War. And let me say why, because I don't know. Let me just real quick. Civil War had a great story. It gave Tony Stark his ending closure in a way. It closed him out as far as like his story a little bit, I felt. Even though it's more of a Tony Stark movie than it is, or Iron Man movie than it is Captain America movie. I feel like Endgame is kind of cheap with the whole time travel thing. I feel like a cheap way to make I feel like a cheap way to end the saga. So I might say Civil War. And Civil War is just
okay.
I'm gonna go with Civil War as well. I think Civil War, the thing that movie does is because it's like it leaves you conflicted because you see a lot of characters. And ultimately, a lot of these characters, like the two, Captain America and Iron Man, you kind of see their views. See both sides. And also, their characters kind of change. I mean, we see Captain America as this perfect Boy Scout in the first couple movies, and then you find out in Civil War that he lied the whole time to Tony about the whole Bucky situation. So you kind of see a change in his character, like, oh, okay, maybe he is kind of...
Well, also, he was Peggy officially in that movie, too. Peggy dies in that movie.
Yeah, so...
And old man Steve Rogers carries Peggy's casket. Remember?
Wait, are you serious?
Yeah, that was confirmed.
Oh, damn. Wow.
Yeah, they show one of the guys who carries Peggy's...
The casket?
Casket, yeah. They confirmed that one of those guys is old man.
I know, that's my head.
Wow,
I know
that.
Yeah. So worry even more now. I'll still worry anyway, though. Yeah.
Okay, Tony, what are you picking?
You're out of your mind. It's endgame. There's no way. There's no way.
I mean, for me, again, you know, this was accumulation of 10 years in the making. It all led up to this final battle between good and evil. And I get chills to this day still watching the portal scene on YouTube. I can just look at what YouTube and watch it.
I get that.
It's so, like, and I know people will say, like, you know, it's not really cinema. Like, you know, like, in the art of, like, real acting, it's all CGI most. But that, to me, is, like, the greatest segment of, like, movie history.
I get what you're saying. To me, Infinity War was my end game, if that makes sense.
I get it.
Like, Infinity War was my, oh, man. Like, you know what I mean? So, but I get what you're saying. I'm not knocking off for Endgame. Endgame's tight, too.
I'm going to go Endgame. We're having rock, paper, scissors. We're going to have drama here in the final four.
All right.
Who do I want to play? Well, DeAndre lost the last time, yeah, so that's probably the weaker one.
Okay, wow. That's true. Aren't you?
Aren't you?
Alec, you're going to lose, Alec.
Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot.
Yes!
Civil War moves on.
I fell for the strategy. I picked scissors again, and it came back to bite me. Okay.
Oh, yes.
So Infinity War and the First Avengers.
I love it for you. First Avengers, that people forget that camera scene where it goes around the whole team in New York for the first time.
Yeah.
That gets me still to this day. I was like, oh man, all these characters together for the first time. Like you said about whole Berlin stuff, like that's the first time you see all these characters. First time you ever see a universe that's all connected with characters put together in one film.
Yeah, that's true. It's a very compelling point.
It is. That's Infinity War is tough though, but Avengers is like that's the start.
I have a counterpoint.
Okay.
I can name a more iconic scene when Thor comes into Wakanda.
Damn.
That's type two. Yeah. No, that's type two. Yeah. What about when Iron Man, Hulk finally arrives? I'm always angry, and the Hulk just pops out. That's something. I mean, and then the Hulk versus Thor fight scene on the aircraft.
Okay, but Drax stole the show in Infinity Wars. Why is she? Or when Doctor Strange says, name your what Lord do you serve? What am I supposed to say? Jesus?
Yeah,
from Missouri. What is repetition?
Shit, yeah. Look, I'm gonna go with Infinity War. I with your point with the Avengers and seeing them all come together, that's why I think
that's the best Hulk also. That's the best one I got on all of MCU.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
I could agree with that. But Infinity War, I mean, it does that too as far as like bringing everyone together. You see all these people from all these different movies, whether it's Doctor Strange, with the Guardians, all of them connected.
Let me argue this. By that point of Infinity War, you've already seen people connected. You've already seen Black Panther on screen with Captain America. You've seen Doctor Strange and Thor Ragnarok. You've seen all these characters already connected in a way. Sure, you get them on screen for a whole movie, but you've seen them all connected. Avengers is the first time you see all these characters in one universe together.
I'm going to say this as well. I mean, I like Loki, don't get me wrong, but Thanos, like, that was the first time we actually got to see the Mad Titan in action.
Mm-hmm.
Facts.
And that man was a problem. That's the first movie that I came out, I was like, what the fuck
just happened? And the ending, too, because, like, when everyone disappears, you think there's more to it, right?
And then it just ends.
You like your shawarma, bro? The shawarma scene?
It's nice, don't get me wrong.
But Infinity War, we were traumatized.
Yeah.
For sure. No, I get that, but, I mean, Loki wasn't a bad villain, and the whole...
I never said he was. I'm just saying, but compared to Thanos...
No, of course. That's the case, and we should have kept Endgame could have stayed alive over Benzemo.
Wait, what?
Is it Benzemo? From Civil War.
Zemo? Yeah.
Zemo. Why is it Benzemo? Zemo. You could take an endgame with Thanos over Zemo. That endgame was...
I'm not saying Thanos is the one problem. I'm not saying that's the one reason. I'm just saying that's one of the reasons.
What's the other reason?
Huh?
What's the other reason?
Well, I said also the characters coming together. That's one. And at the end of the movie, you're like, damn, you're speechless because of everything that transpired.
You think there's more, but that's it.
Alright. Plus, there were some badass... Whether it was the Wakanda fight scene.
Thor fighting Captain America and Iron Man in the forest.
Thanos fighting Doctor Strange. Thanos fighting Iron Man.
No, Thanos was tight. Oh, I get you. I agree. I think it's going to... Okay, toss up. Fine.
See, in the beginning, bro, I was like...
I guess we rock, paper, scissors.
In the beginning, like... No, but what's crazy about that movie, in the beginning, man, I knew this man was a problem. When that man 12-pieced the Hulk... And turned him into Bruce for the rest of the movie.
And that's when we knew Hulk was whack.
How bad you have to whoop a man's ass where he doesn't even, he doesn't have the will to be angry anymore?
Yep. Totally, yeah.
All right, so you're going Infinity War.
I'm going Infinity War.
I'm going Infinity War.
And Tony went Infinity War too, right?
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
All right, so that means your championship matchup, Civil War and Infinity War.
Civil War.
This is hard.
Infinity War for me.
I'm going to go Infinity War.
Damn. Let me ask y'all a question. Y'all watch Star Wars? Are y'all Star Wars fans?
Yeah.
Which favorite Star Wars movie? There's a quick, I'm just, okay. Quick question. I'm just curious. All of them. New, old, all of them.
Well, it's definitely none of the new ones.
Of course, I agree.
Yeah, it's definitely none of the new ones.
Agreed.
It's either episode 5.
Okay.
Or it might be Revenge of the Sith.
Okay. You? Either 3 or 5. I'm probably going to lean more towards 5.
I lean more towards 3. The meme quality content is
okay, I was curious. I was just curious, because to me, if you were to say Infinity War and you like Empire Strikes Back, your favorite Star Wars movie. You have to be like the same.
Yeah.
So I was curious to see what y'all were at. Okay, that's fine. I'm going to Civil War still, but I don't know what y'all were with.
No, wait, I didn't even decide.
I thought you were going to ride with even ride with Infinity War.
No, I was actually going to say Civil War.
It comes down to a rock, paper, scissors.
I just like the story of conflict between teammates. So that's one of the reasons I like it so much.
That's true. All right, then. I guess we got to... Tony, do you want to... Oh, no, you're on Skype. Tony, I got us. Don't worry. I got you. Don't worry.
You want to take Javante this time?
Yeah, I'm taking Javante this time. Learn my lesson. You've been over there talking that mess the entire time, but it's time to put your mouth where your rock, paper, and scissors are at.
Ready? On shoot.
Yeah, we're not weird.
All right. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot.
Damn. Hey, yes, sir.
I always go rock, bro. You should work, you fool. It worked against you.
Yeah. And that'll do it.
So did you Infinity War win? I'm cool with that, though. I'm not mad. As long as Endgame didn't win, I was cool.
Yeah, so it would be your final four in order would be Infinity War, Civil War, Avengers, Endgame.
That's
your order. I dig it.
Hey, you forgot Incredible Hulk 2 in there.
We took it out
for
Reese.
We took it out for Sean.
Okay.
Hey,
you're an MCU movie.
I'm not even gonna lie. If you would have put Incredible Hulk over there, I would have chose it over some other movie.
And now something up the air after that.
I'll be honest with you. That's where we have technical.
I'm be honest with you. I'll choose it over some other movies.
Oh man, that was fun though.
When March hits, brackets for days. That's all we're gonna do.
For sure.
Forget free agency in the NFL. Forget whatever happens in the NBA. It's bracket time. That's all it is. This has been the Final Drive from Alec, Tony, DeAndre, and Javante signing off. We'll see you guys next week.
All right, you guys, that'll be all for the show. If you want to see the rest of it, be sure to click in the link down in the description part of this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and that'll be all. Thank you, guys.